I am super excited to be here today with my friend Greg Raley. I've known Greg for about 35 years. I say known. When I first met him, he was doing worship in a local congregation, and that was my first seeing him. I didn't really see him, but he was a very passionate worship leader, and I loved him, and needed that at that moment in my life. I had just moved back to South Carolina from LA, and being a part of the Vineyard out there. And that was the beginning. It would be just a few months later that actually we would initiate the church plant that I did there. But through the years, came to really know and really respect Greg for the prophetic calling and gifting on his life. He was actually the one who introduced me. I remember one of those meetings that we had, Greg, where you brought in a boombox and you played Shout to the Lord. I remember that. And listen to this song, you know. And but I remember that, you know, we would gather. There were times that we would have many pastors and leaders gathering on a Tuesday morning from all throughout the region. And then near the end of those gatherings, we would move into prophetic stuff. And there were things you spoke over my life. There were things that you spoke over so many lives. And then later on in the 90s, you actually hosted a conference where God really touched my life, but also during that time also touched who I didn't know, but my future bride, Karen. And to this day, those meetings have had impact in our lives. Some of those words I've listened to even recently that were released during that period of time. There's other stories that we can go into, and we probably will today. You have carried a part of a different side of prophetic utterance. I remember that a few years ago, I had a friend of mine who people would know on this feed, who was very much involved in ministry in the same streams that I was. And she called me. She said, "Hey, who is that red-haired, hairy man who's a prophet? I need his phone number." And she called you and asked you to call somebody who would be later healed as a result of your prophetic word and a number of things in his life. I'm not going to go into the details of that, but it was just one of those things. And I remember obviously the things that happened with you in the Philippines. We may talk about that a little bit today. But just some things where I want people to get an understanding that the prophetic is not simply a matter of just calling people out in a meeting and giving them a nice encouraging word. It's also not one of those things that is just maintained or kept in a church situation or to believers, that actually God uses us in other ways. And you've also shared some stories with me that you may be able to vaguely share, but some clandestine prophetic stuff that has occurred that you know about, that are just very real in the world today, that people need to understand that the prophetic realm is not what we have. It's not on your prophetic feeds on Facebook. Let me just put it that way. And it's not what most people are familiar with, that there is truly a gift of the prophetic, and that it is very needful today. And you know, you shared something with me before we began broadcasting, and I want to just say to you that I jokingly said something to you, but I personally believe that one of the things that God is doing with a lot of us is trimming back some things, because actually what lays ahead of us is far greater than what lay behind us. and that the word and the voice that God has given to you, God is not relenting on it. He's not moving away from it, that what God has called you and Jan into is about to take a very powerful turn. As a mark of that is going to be a profound healing that God is going to release all over both of you in the joint areas, in the muscle areas, in the heart areas, and that God is about to restore and literally put breath back into your sails, that there's going to be a release of that. And so I heard that, and I wanted to share that with you, because I even believe the timing of this prophet's chamber is something that God's going to use in your life. And my prayer is that God will use it to absolutely open so many, not opening doors. You don't need doors open, but you need for the Father to absolutely direct and send you into some places that maybe have been shuttered, and God's about to unshutter some things. So I'm just excited about that. So welcome, Greg.
Thank you, man. Yeah. It's been a joy to be in relationship. The loneliness of some things, some callings and some mandates on a lot of lives is kind of a thing where you wonder in between times. It'll be really a remarkable thing that God does, which you know you had no part in doing anything about it except just obeying. And then it's a remarkably lonely time between. And everybody wants to know what you're doing, what, you know, what's happening, blah, blah, blah. And you hate to say, well, nothing really. And but that's the way it is a lot of times. But anyway, but I agree. You know, I jokingly say the shift is just about to hit the fan with emphasis on the F.
Yeah.
There is a shift that's happening in the earth that is so stupendous is the word that just came to me. It is so remarkable. The overflow, the release, the activation, the impartation of so many that have been in places where they've wondered, what in the world is going on? God, are you going to use me ever again? We just did here in Columbia at a church that we've plugged into, Satish and Nikki. And we just did a prophetic boot camp. And, you know, we've done three or four of those over the last month. And 100 to 150 people showed up, most of them not even a part of that church, in this region. And these people are people that are just have been sitting. And the religious atmosphere has pretty much suppressed them. And they haven't been interested in it. And these people literally were thinking, you know, I must be crazy with what, and the joy to activate people in who they're called to be and let them know that this is a set time.
Amen.
An appointed time for them to get ready, because it's going to blow their socks off what God's going to do through them. Yeah. And that's the joy of this season we're in.
It's so good. It is good. And, you know, in fact, it's to me, the facet of the prophetic, and I'll throw this verse out. I was talking with somebody today, and we were just talking about how so much of what is coming out right now, to me, it's fluffy. I can remember the movie. There was a kid's movie, and it said, "It's so fluffy." I can't remember exactly which movie that was, but it was so funny, because I was thinking about what I'm seeing with a lot of stuff happening in the prophetic. I'm going, it's so fluffy. It's like, come on, you know, where is the precision? I remember Robbie, it was, once came up at one of the end of those meetings, and he looked at me after we had just finished, you know, a period of time of just prophesying over each other, and he goes, "Dude, you need your sword sharpened. It's pretty rusty." I was like, "You're right. You know, I've been kind of hanging back and not pressing forward in what was happening." And we all hit those things, you know. Hello, Elijah hit that thing. I can't imagine he had a lot of ministry to the ravens at the Brook Cherith. You know, it's like just not a whole lot happening out here, but we hit those seasons. But they're not the end of it, because the call of God continues on our lives. And I really, you know, I want to, just because these things produce faith in people. And in fact, let me just tell you that, you know, you had a word for Karen before we moved up here. So that was 8 years ago, literally 8 years ago. And in that, you said that when she came up here, that she would have friends. And she does have friends. And there just are some things that God has done in our lives through some of those little words that were spoken over our lives. And that is one facet of what's happening. When I talked about the fluffy thing, I was thinking about, you know, the Revelation, what's it, 19:10, where it says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. To me, that means the prophetic word should sound as if Jesus just walked in the room. Something is different. This isn't just an encouraging, nice little thing. And we've taught so many to do the nice, encouraging things, and we've used the name prophecy in a very vague way, to such a degree that you go, well, are they functioning by revelation? You know, because it's only revelation that Jesus says will build his church to Peter. It's only really hearing from the Father. We have to hear from the Father. But, you know, one of the stories that to me is one of the most exciting stories that you've ever shared with me was a story of what happened to you when you went to the Philippines. Now, you might have a bunch of other ones, but that one is so pertinent because of actually who you guys ended up ministering to. And I have been speaking to people a lot recently and telling them that the prophetic gifting, the prophetic call, is not biblically, is not so much a word for the church as much as it actually is for governments. That
yes,
you they went to kings, they went to leaders, they went to rulers. That was in fact the calling that was on a prophet, and we have just completely Christianized the whole thing and thrown all prophets before believers. And in fact, the greater part of the calling and the gift, which was Elijah, which was Elisha, which was Jeremiah, which was Daniel, we can just go back through the whole line, and we begin realizing, man, this call that is on God's people right now, the prophetic, is intended to touch the earth, touch the world. And so I wanted to kind of bring you into that by... Why don't you just share the story with us? Because obviously you remember it a whole lot better than I do. For me, it was just like, man, this is like really amazing stuff. But share with us, what was it that happened? And this was a number of years ago, so we'll just make that clear. But I believe that these are the type of things that God is about to do with people who actually function prophetically. Not people who are encouragers, not people who are preachers, but actual prophetic vessels of God that he's about to raise up on the earth. Go ahead.
You know, the thing that's, I think, important, just a little preface to that, is I grew up in a Pentecostal pastor's home, and, you know, we didn't believe in prophets, had no clue about prophets. And then I got introduced to Bill Hammond and in the 1980, and the first, actually Leland Davis was the first prophet that prophesied over me. And I thought, this guy must have been reading the book of Revelation too much or something. That's weird, all this stuff he's saying, you know. And then just 5 or 6 months later, Bill Hammond came to the church I was on staff at, and he called out all the pastoral staff and the first night and their families and prophesied. And he began to prophesy, and he said, after I'd led worship for an hour and a half, and then he got up and preached an hour and a half, then he started prophesying, and he said, there'll come a day when you'll prophesy by the hour. You'll literally prophesy from one day into the next. You'll travel north, south, east, west, and you'll be prophesying to kings and presidents and prime ministers and government officials, and the word of the Lord will be very sharp in your mouth, and it will transform nations. And he went on and on and on, but that's the crux of it. And I commonly refer to that by saying during that time, I used the phrase, I was thinking in my mind, when donkeys fly, I don't even understand what he's saying.
Yeah.
And fast forward to almost 10 years later, I left the staff, Jan and I did, and we literally, I never could conceive of this. We literally traveled north, south, east, west. We, from the first meeting we had when we left the staff as a worship leader, the first meeting we had, I ended up, the first night, I ended up prophesying from by the hour, like I led worship. And then the next place we went, I went to prophesy, and we were going to be there 3 days. And the word of the Lord started flowing, and we ended up one night, we started prophesying after we had taught at 10 o'clock, and we finished prophesying at 6 o'clock the next morning, a church of about 600. And they literally, people were leaving, going home, getting their family, getting kids, bringing them back, and they were just handing me bottles of water. And I prophesied for 8 hours straight. And I kept that, the Holy Spirit kept whispering in my ear, donkeys are flying, and I couldn't foresee myself doing that. And during that meeting that I'm just referring to, I was asked to go and to the office after a Sunday service that ended about 3 o'clock, and a woman who was on staff at the church had had a series of 12 strokes.
Wow.
In a window of about 6 weeks. And she had been in the hospital, and she was the office manager for this church. And this particular Sunday morning, her adult daughter brought her into the service because they were having a guest speaker, I'm a guest speaker. And so when we came out of the pastor's office, we walked out, and as we walked past her, she was at the back on the, against the wall with her daughter, and she was slumped over and drooling and, absolutely, totally destroyed by this series of strokes. And the pastor just, said, I want you to meet so-and-so, and I just greeted her, and then we went on up to the platform. So we got through ministering. At the end of the service, we took people back into worship again. And, 600 people are standing up worshiping, and the pastor, all of a sudden, I looked to my right on the floor, and he's laid on the floor just sobbing with his face down. And everybody in the crowd was just screaming and hollering as we're continuing to worship. And as we did so, I looked, and there was somebody running around the building. And I thought, this is really wild. What in the world's going on? We just went on and worshiped. And finally, about the third or fourth time that this person made a lap around the building, the pastor crawled over and was pulling on my leg. And I looked down at him, and he said, that's that woman. And I said, no. And he said, that's that woman. And literally, it was that woman. She had come out of the wheelchair, and she was making laps around this huge building. And the place went up in smoke. And what was going to be a three-day meeting ended up going for almost 5 weeks. And at the end of one of the Sunday morning services, the pastor said, I want you to come back in my office and with your team. I'd even brought my team from Columbia down after the meetings kept extended. So we were in the pastor's office, and he had a quite large office. And he said, there's a friend of mine that I want you to minister to, and she's in the Manila in the Philippines, and she was a very integral part and still is of our church. She's a, and I won't tell you anymore. Let's just see what God has to say for her. And so we all gathered around. Our team was in there. His leadership was in there. And he got her on a speakerphone. And I'll just use the phrase Maybird just as a code. And he said, Maybird, this is the prophet I've been telling you about. And so he's going to minister to you. And so I opened my mouth and I heard the Lord say, look at the wall. And on the end of his office, one whole wall turned into like a complete screen, like a closed circuit screen, 15 by 20. And the Lord just said, watch the screen and describe what you see. And so I began to describe, and I saw this lady, and she was standing at the corner of this desk, and there's this guy with a big pot belly, and his belly was, the shirt was gaped open, and he was standing at the corner of the desk as well. And he walked over, and at the far edge of the desk, there were two stacks of documents, and he put his hands on these two stacks of documents, and he just took them and switched places with each other. And then the Lord said, look at the documents. And I looked at the documents, and it was like as if a video screen went up, or a camera went up over above the documents and came down, and I could read the headline on the document, and I could not read the body of the document, but I could read the bottom of part of the document. And so I'm reading this off and just declaring what I'm seeing. And so this lady, Maybird, is just sobbing, and she's laughing, and she's the thing lasted like 34 minutes. And at the end, she was just weeping, and she said to the pastor, she said, this is most unbelievable. She said, I just finished that meeting about an hour and a half ago. And she said, everything that he described in detail was exactly what took place in that meeting, including the documents. He read what the top of the document was, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so that began a year process where every single night, regardless of where I was in the country, I would call, or he would call me, he would call her and link us together, and we would talk, and I would minister to her. She was a very, very influential person who had been used in multiple countries, a very high-tech offshore banker. She had banked for some of the largest countries in the world and the largest leaders of countries, and the Anwar Sadat before he was killed. She was his personal banker, and she would move billions of dollars around. She was a specialist in documents and so forth. And the reason I'm bringing that up is because that all laid a foundation for the following January. She invited me over, and I went over with a friend of mine, took him with me, and we were there for, we were supposed to be there for about 7 days. And so the first weekend we were there, he got there actually before I did. And so on a Saturday night, I came in, and I was jet lagged and all this. And she, the first morning, the next morning, Sunday morning, she said, I have a meeting set up with the leader of our nation. And she said, it's going to be tonight. And she said, so you'd better get as much sleep as you can fast, because it's set up, and he's coming back early from a business, from a government trip to receive the word of the Lord over our nation. So I said, okay. So I went and tried to crash a little while, but no, I didn't know this was going to be set up. So, you know, I'm freaking. Now, again, when I was being trained in the prophetic, quote unquote, to be a blessing to others, with Bill Hammond, he's known for activating every kind of way possible. Anytime you're ever in a conference, he activates at the end of the conference. And I would always slip out as soon as he started doing that, when he'd say, all right, front row, turn around and face the second row, third row, face the fourth row, join hands, all that. I'd slip out and go in the bathroom until they were through with the activations. I scared spitless. And I did that for so many years. And one year or one night, I came back in and was standing in the back. And so Bishop Hammond said, "Does everybody have a partner?" And he looked all the way through. He's standing on the stage. And then he said, "Greg," he said, "do you have a partner?" And I was like, "Oh my God, if I hadn't already used the bathroom, I would have then." And he said, "Why don't you come up here and be my partner?" And I was like, "Oh my God." And so here I was required to go up on the stage and join hands with Bishop Bill Hammond to exchange the word of the Lord. And God just set me up. And because again, it was one of those things that I just, you know, and so I say that because there's so many times great fear and trepidation when you're placed in situations, but yet there comes a time when it's never, ever, ever that it's not by faith, and then by faith. I've prophesied to 10, 15,000 people, maybe, I don't even know. But right now, my heart starts beating sometimes and thumping, you know, when I know that I'm going to minister to someone the word of the Lord, because of just my own fears, my own, you know, stuff. So I just want everybody to know that. It's not anything wrong with that. So I'm at this place, and so we'd slept, and we're getting ready to go to this meeting, and we're riding in these little jitneys. If you've ever been to the Philippines, they're a nightmare to ride in. And I'm sitting there in this thing, jumping around, and Ken, my friend, is with me. And Ken says, "Bro," he says, "you got a word for this guy?" And I said, "Nope." He said, "Oh gosh." He said, "What are we going to do?" I said, "Man, I don't know. You better be praying, because I don't have a word." And I didn't have a word. And so we're getting closer and closer to this venue, and we literally were going to meet in the Manila Hotel in the lounge in the very back, 3 a.m. in the morning. This leader of this nation had flown back in, et cetera, et cetera. So as we're getting close to it, pretty close to it, the Spirit of the Lord just, I heard it just as clear in the middle of all the bouncing around in the jitney and all this. And the Lord said, "When you get there and when you have the opportunity to speak, ask him if he has a daughter who is college age and who is in another country." And I said, "Okay, I can do that. What else?" And nothing. Nothing. So I said, "Ken, I got a word." And I told him. He said, "What else?" I said, "Nothing." I said, "Keep praying." Nothing else came. Nothing else came. We get there. We're surrounded. We're in a party of 12. And we're surrounded by about 10 military guys with machine guns. Literally, they're maybe 8 to 10 feet away from us. And I'm seated by this leader of this nation, and I'm seated next to him, and then my host is on the other side. So we're chitty-chatting around, and everybody's eating except me, because my guts are turning inside out, you know. And finally, he said in broken English, "So Maybird says you have a word for me." And I said, "Yes, sir, I do." And he said, "Please give it to me." And I said, "Okay, sir, do you have a daughter that's college age that's in another country?" And he said, "Yes, I do." And I was saying, "Okay, Lord, what's the next deal?" Okay, he's got a daughter. So what do I say? And I heard myself say, "Sir, your daughter is going to be kidnapped from her college dorm, and she's going to be taken by the cartel." And she and about that time, all of the group was keenly aware something was happening, because these 10 guys with machine guns were now about 3 feet from us. And I said, "Sir, Okay. And I just took a deep breath in and I said, sir, you're not to tell your daughter, you're not to tell your wife. Your daughter will be, this is a political opponent who has done this and put it together. She will be not be able to be found for a short amount of time, and she will be found, she will be safe, she will be returned on a government plane to you safely. And when this happens, the rest of what I'm telling you for your country will be, you'll know that this is a sign that the rest is going to be fulfilled. And he said, sir, you better hope so. And I was thinking, oh yes, I better hope so. And I'm thinking, Lord, what is this? And so I finished and I went ahead and prophesied to him about his nation and what God was going to do. And one of the things was that there was going to be a massive gathering that would be a prophetic gathering that would literally be on the television networks. It would transform their nation. It would transform their leadership, et cetera, et cetera. And I had the joy of seeing that happen. About 8 years later, Bishop Hammond went over along with Tom Hammond and another part of the team. And they did they had an outdoor event that they had over 1 million people show up in the streets. And it was broadcast for 2 nights, broadcast all over the nation. And so that was just one part of it. And so many other things that happened with that. But as we left, and the next morning, we were to be back in that same lounge at 10 o'clock to meet with the general. He was like the 5-star general. He'd like to be the general over the all of the military in that nation. And so we were sitting in that venue. Now, a lot transpired over the night. I didn't even sleep. You know, I was freaked out. And my host was kind of freaked out about it. And we were all, in fact, freaked out. And so the next morning, we're there meeting a general. And he was in his military uniform with his wife. And he also had a college-age daughter with him. And we're sitting there talking. And as soon as we sat down, I looked at him and I saw through his military uniform what they call, you know, if someone has open heart surgery, they call it the zipper, the scar on their chest. I saw through that, I saw he had a zipper on his chest. And I said, so we general, you know, chit chat for a little bit. And I said, sir, I said, can I ask you a question? Do you have a heart condition? And his wife just burst out weeping, and his daughter burst out weeping. And he said, yes, sir, I do. Now, this man's about 6'7". He's a massive man. And I said, do you have a zipper? Do you have a scar? And he said, yes, I do. I said, not only does God want to heal your natural heart, but as a sign of his spiritual, him healing your spiritual heart and the brokenness of your heart, he's also going to heal your natural heart. And all of them were weeping, including him, tears coming down his face. And he said, his wife began to explain what was going on then. About that time, the assistant to the leader of the nation, his name is July. I'm still a friend with him on Facebook today. July came running into that meeting, and he broke up the meeting with the general, and he said, Profita, Profita, you must hear. And I said, what's going on? And he said, you know what you said last night? That just happened. He said, we've just been notified that, and I had described, the word of the Lord had described the leader of the nation. The place where he had his office was on like the third floor. And God described his office inside, the color of the walls, the carpet. And I said, you can see across the street into another building on the second floor, and your military, your political opponent is in a room with red carpet, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He's a very tempestuous man. He's got anger, and you meet with him sometime on a regular basis. He said, that's right. I meet with him every Monday morning. So at 7 o'clock. So what? And I said, I saw this guy gritting his teeth and clenching his fist and saying, "You will pay for this." And he was screaming at this guy. And so July said, he had a meeting this morning and the man did just what you said last night. He screamed at him and said, "You will pay for this." And 2 hours later, his daughter was kidnapped from her college dorm by the Chinese mafia. And at the time then, they did not know where she was. And so I said, "General, can we please be excused from this meeting?" And I didn't want to tell, I didn't say, but I wanted to say, we got to go pray for our lives right now. And so we all, the general left, we right there in that lounge at the back of the hotel, we, man, we began to pray. I mean, I never prayed like I prayed then. And we prayed for about 2 hours or so. And about 2 hours later, July comes running into the lounge, big smile on his face. He said, "Profita, it worked. It worked. God is God." And what happened was they had found her. They had her at that point on a military plane, bringing her back to the Manila. And so that set up something. We were supposed to be there 7 days, and it ended up being, we were there 30 days, and wow, we were meeting every single night with a different person in government, what would be equivalent to our senators, et cetera, et cetera, and meeting with them and ministering the word of the Lord over them. And it just was a phenomenal, astounding thing that blew my mind. And again, Holy Spirit just shouted this time, "Donkeys are flying." And when you said donkeys are fly, when donkeys fly, then he said, "I'm just showing you that I knew what I was talking about." The difference in time, Danny, was when Bishop Hammond gave me that word as a Pentecostal Assemblies of God kid who just loved worship, to the time that took place was exactly 20 years. Wow. Literally.
Wow.
From January of 2000, and I mean, 1981 till January of 2001. And so the word of the Lord was astounding. During that time and that trip, there were so many things I cannot explain or divulge what the documents were. But since that time, I have been in Washington, D.C. I've been subpoenaed there. I have sat and given the word of the Lord to previous administrations. Literally, I was sitting in that subpoena, where we were subpoenaed. We were just finishing up, and the individual I was, the legal counsel that was conducting that, we were walking to the elevator and in a hotel just two blocks from the White House. And I saw a picture of one of our former vice presidents. And I saw his back seated at a desk and a gentleman across from him. And this gentleman was a mixture of Asian English descent. And he was a Secret Service. He had, you know, the deal in his ear and all this kind of stuff. And the vice president turned around in what I was seeing and faced me. And the gentleman behind him, the Secret Service guy, I saw him open up his coat and show, as if he were revealing to me, showed me his weapons, and he closed his coat. The vice president got up and left the room. And when he did, this guy came around and he put a flash drive into the vice president's computer. And he left it there for 2 minutes, maybe, pulled it out and stuck it in his pocket. And then he left the room. The person that I was being interviewed by, it was a in the the three-letter agencies, I'll say that, at the top of the three-letter, one of the alphabet soup agencies. And I said to him, can I just share with you this before you leave? And he was actually taking all the documents and all that transpired in that subpoena, and he was sending it to somewhere where in 15 minutes it would be on the president's desk, what took place in that meeting. And so I shared with him what I just got through telling you. And he said, we will make sure and monitor that. Less than 2 weeks later, in fact, it was about 7 or 8 days later, I got a call from him, and he said, and he referred me to the Post in DC, and two or three other newspapers. He said, go look at the headlines. And I went and looked on screen at the headlines, and that individual that we're talking about, that I didn't know the name, but that Secret Service agent had literally been taking and stealing government secrets, putting them on flash drive and sending them back to his country. And they caught him in the middle of doing that, and they, of course, took appropriate actions. And so, again, all that tied into some of the things that were taking place. Just it was a series of events that continued. Since that time, every time we've gone out of country to another nation, we've ended up ministering to the heads of state. In some way, God pulls it off and brings it together. From a Pentecostal preacher's kid who didn't believe in prophecy, didn't know anything about prophecy, to ministering the word of the Lord. And yeah. I started thinking, well, maybe there's governmental anointings for just some people. And the Lord just started showing me in scripture, as you prefaced it a little bit earlier, that that the kings literally were totally reliant on the prophets.
Yeah.
The kings were. And I can say to this day, in our nation, that is the case. Thank God that is the case.
Yeah.
And there's so many things that can't be talked about now, but God has supernaturally positioned individuals. And again, the contacts come only by the most, the wildest set of circumstances set up the most unique things where God allows us to step in and just be obedient, just as if we were ministering to you, me, and another friend or two. But not, like you say, not just the fluff, God loves you, he wants to bless you, blah, 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 blah. No, this is the time in the seasons where it literally, the voice of the Lord is shifting and altering the course of nations and destinies. Sheep nations, goat nations, where there's nations that are being defined and identified, and the leaders of those nations, they may not even be believers, but the God who is the one who owns the earth is directing them. That's why Psalm 2 is such a powerful, powerful statement.
Yeah.
Why do the nations rise up and they assemble in an uproar and they say, let us break their bands of restraint asunder? That's identifying the fact that we, with the word of the Lord in our mouth, put a restraining order on the princes of darkness and uncover darkness. And that's why Isaiah said, arise from the prostration in which and the circumstances have kept you, and arise and be radiant with joy, for the glory of the Lord has come and your light has come. And that's what I wanted to say more than anything. Your light, our light has come. It is the light of revelation. And every time I wanted to make sure and say this, I believe every time I go to minister to someone, whether it's in a church, whether it's in a restaurant, that's one of my main ministry venues is sitting in restaurants, and I'll be sitting there, and immediately, if you just sit or sensitive and open up your heart, just like you do in a service, but you're sitting there and looking at the waiter or waitress or somebody across the room, and God begins to speak. My family already, they've got to the point where they just say, okay, Dad, would you just go ahead and give the word so we can finish talking and finish the meal? You know, because I'm kind of zoned in, and I just, Dad, okay, which, they'll keep looking back, which one is it, you know, kind of thing. But it's the joy of that, and seeing almost every single time. And I joke about this, but I say, I start out by saying, you know, can I just ask your name? Secondly, I don't even know if you believe God, you know, speaks to people, you know, and I'm kind of like giving myself an out. If they say, no, I don't, I say, no, I don't either. And I just, you know, go on and move on with the thing. No, but literally, it's like immediately when you just say those few things, and almost every single time, without exception, they'll drop their head. And when you look, tears are coming down their face. They're so desperate for the voice of God, so desperate for a life-changing word from heaven that transforms. And it I say this because I always do this every single time. Before I give a word, I start believing God and putting my faith out for a word of knowledge to be linked to it. Because that word of knowledge will so open their hearts to hear the rest of what God has to say. It's kind of like that leader in the Philippines. The word of knowledge opened his heart to hear and receive. Right. The general, the word of knowledge opened his heart to hear and receive, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so I believe for that. I put my faith out there for that. So that those, I really believe those two are linked together. So that those two giftings are ministry gifts of Holy Spirit they're essentials in what we release. And so it's not just trying to foretell and forthtell something, but it's to somehow pick up in their lives. And when their lives opened up, you've got an open book, and you've got, as the tongue of a ready writer, you can write on their hearts, and God transforms them. And so I believe the word of the Lord, I say this regularly, but it creates, it forms, or it transforms, or sometimes all three. But because we were created, you know, with Genesis 1, which everybody knows, let us, plurality, us, all three, make man in our image and our likeness. And when I think about that, I'm immediately reminded of Genesis 1 again. And God said, and God said, and God said, and God said, and his saying literally created, it formed, transformed, it brought about radical reformation. And the season where the Word of Faith guys were being birthed, and they were teaching us the power of God's Word. And I grew up, like I said, in a Pentecostal church, Pentecostal denomination. My dad was a Pentecostal preacher in the town that we were in Florida, large central Florida town. There was a church across town that had opened up to the charismatic move. And they were just doing the worship and the dance and all this. And we were sitting across town, you know, criticizing them, saying, how can you just dance just because, you know, you don't have the feel good, you don't have the Holy Ghost, doodads running up and down you. How can they do that? And all of a sudden it dawned on me, they do that just because the word says do it. And so the creating power of the word in, the word of the Lord is going to come back out. It is the same. People say, well, how do you put the prophetic word on the same level as the Logos word that God spoke? No, I'm not putting it on the same level. I'm saying it's coming from the same spirit and it's coming from the same creative force. And so when God said, he did and he created. And when you say, you create, you form, you transform, you release something. And it doesn't have to be something that you have to have some special anointing for. We've already been anointed for that. And so we've been appointed for that, for this season, that we go into this season where our light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon us. Yes, behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and great darkness. And it has, and it is. This is the most depraved darkness but light is shining in on it.
Yeah.
And the things that are being uncovered and the vileness that's being uncovered, that's because there are prophetic mantles that have been released. God's released his light of revelation.
Oh, Greg, I lost you for a second here.
Somebody called in. We're going to see, and we can step into, and I'm closing with this, unless you have something else you want me to say, that's what's happening. That's what we've been bought and paid for. And the gift of God in us is not for us. It is to give away. And it's for this day. There's a desperate people that have to hear us say what God is saying in the earth right now.
Yeah.
So we can't hold back. We've got to release it. There's a deficit, there's a lack, and we can't hold back because God has put us on this glorious prophetic track to release his manifest presence in the earth. And so I just charge everyone that's whether you've just been to the first prophetic activation or whether you've been prophesying for years, start believing to hear with your hearing ear and the stirring of the gift of God in you for your government, your nation, your region, your city, your municipality, your mayor, there's always the door. These guys, when you show up and ask the question, they won't turn you away. They're desperate. They're desperate.
Yeah.
Even the unrighteous and the ungodly, they'll manifest sometimes, but press on in because that's what we've been called to be.
Amen.
In the earth right now.
So good, Greg. You know, you brought up something, and it's very, very unique. I remember the last time I think we were together, you shared the story, and it's actually on the internet. So, I mean, I don't feel bad asking this because I've actually read it as well. But you shared the story about Justin, you obviously had a part to play in that, and it's something that I'm seeing right now. You know, I remember last year, you know, when Kanye West came out and when all that stuff began happening with Kanye and the meetings, and you begin realizing light is about ready to shine in areas that, you know, we want the light to shine, but honestly, what it reveals is sometimes so ugly, so foul, that sometimes we become very afraid. Is this really what we want to see happen? And we do. We do want to see it happen because everything must be uncovered, you know?
Yes.
That's what God is doing. God's been doing that with many of us. You know, I've told people, even in the season we're in, it's very interesting to me. You know, we've been praying for awakening. We've been praying for revival. And if you just take the Welsh revival, just the Welsh revival, you realize that in just that revival alone, and the others were very similar, the awakenings and things like that, but sporting events stopped. Businesses closed. People basically were all focused on one thing. There were people that were dealing with issues in their own heart, and they went to a place where they could focus on God. And I mean, there's a whole lot more than that. But basically, when COVID hit for us, it was like, well, when all this pandemic stuff happened, guess what happened? The business, the sporting events stopped, businesses closed, all kinds of the same kind of entertainment industries, everything shut down. Exactly what would occur, in fact, in an awakening, in a revival. And we're praying for revival. But then it was like, we all got sent to our room. We all got sent home. Why? Because I think God was saying, I want to deal with your hearts. I want to deal with the hearts of a nation. I don't want to just put you in crowds and in meetings. I want you to deal with your personal heart. What are you dealing with? And in the midst of that, I believe we are absolutely in awakening. People are being awakened, and in the awakening process, we're seeing demonic things happen. You and I both know that when somebody is manifesting, it's because the demon is coming out. It is exposing itself. And so we've been watching people coming out for years, you know, in homosexuality, lesbianism, transsexual, whatever. They've been coming out of the closet, and we've all been like, oh no, stay back in the closet. We don't want you. And the Lord says, no, they're manifesting because this is being exposed, because you cannot, listen, sin has to be covered, but it has to be acknowledged as sin. The only way the blood of Jesus covers things is in the acknowledgement, like, I am a sinner. I am lost. This is an area that's broken in my life. And so when people come out, I understand many are not in a repentant state, but it is like God is exposing it, and he's saying, they're coming out. They're bringing to a point where they're going to begin recognizing there is sin. There are things that have to be broken. There are things that have to be shattered in their life in order for the blood of Jesus to cleanse them, to forgive them, to wash over them, and to set them into the journey and purpose that I have for them. And I'm watching that. I'm watching it in a very different way. I didn't expect it like this. I don't think any of us expected anything like this. Do I believe that there's a mass harvest coming in? Absolutely.
Yes.
I believe it is. I believe it is way beyond what we think it is. I think Bob Jones, you know, his word about a billion young people coming in, I think that was a great start, because I think that he was speaking of the young people. But I believe that it's going to be way more than just the young people.
And, you know, Danny, we keep forgetting, and everybody says, well, you can't be this harsh. But God says the foundation of my throne is righteousness and justice.
Yeah.
And so there is going to be a plumb line that's the sword's dropped. And what God says about his word in Hebrews, it does sever. It does cut away. It does divide. It does separate. And there are those who are in the pits of vileness and depravity and darkness that will have an opportunity. They've had opportunity.
Right.
And this is a harsh word, but we're seeing this now, and we're seeing it. We're going to see more than we've ever seen before.
Right.
What's going to be uncovered that's been in motion that has caused this nation to be under a curse, a blood curse. And it's I have opportunity I've had the opportunity to be told and to sit with people who are the ones that are carrying out the sealed indictments. They're unsealing them and arresting the individuals. One of the biggest blights on this nation, but it's actually worldwide, is sex trafficking and pedophilia. the destruction of children and so forth. But probably most people don't realize it goes right over their head. You know, the abortion issue is rooted in the satanic ritual abuse of shedding the blood of children, draining the blood out, and them actually drinking the blood, the adrenochrome. That's, and if you've listened to Justin Bieber's testimony.
Go ahead, share that. I haven't shared that here. Go ahead, share that.
His testimony is actually on, available publicly now. A friend of mine in Canada, a prophet friend of mine, was best friends with Justin's mom. And Jeff would regularly call me and just say, "Hey man, I've got some folks in my office." He converted. He's got a beautiful home and he business and all this. He was heavily involved in the ministry in Florida during the Todd Bentley meetings and all that. And Jeff was, that's where I met him. And then we became very good friends. And Jeff's a powerful prophet, got his own a testimony that's phenomenal. But Jeff had Patty Bieber in his office, along with two other couples, pastors and their wives. And he always would call and say, "Hey man, what you doing?" And I knew what he's wanting. He wanted me to prophesy. I'd try and figure out how to get out of it. And he'd say, "Look, dude, just go ahead and minister to these people and then you can go do what you want to do." But Jeff's a cool guy. And he said, "I got two pastors and their wives and then one other." And so I ministered to the one pastor and his wife. Jeff recorded it on his iPhone and they were crying and all this, and then ministered to the second couple. And he said, "Greg," he said, "can you just minister to this one lady?" I said, "Sure." And he said, "I'm not going to tell you anything about her. Just, you know, would you minister to her?" And so I just started prophesying to her. And in the middle of prophesying to her, and this was about 9 years ago now, I just said, "I keep seeing a young man, maybe almost 16 years old." I said, "This young man is called to be a David to his generation. He will have a unique sound. He will be he'll travel the world, but there'll be a season when he'll literally turn his back on God. But there is coming a time prior to his, I think it was his 20th or 21st birthday. I forget what I don't remember the timeline now, but at that point he will turn back and return to the Lord. But the Lord says to you, Mom, that you're going to have to stay on your knees because there is going to be everything from hell to steal what heaven has deposited in him. And there will be this young man." I said, "I've never said this before in my life, but this young man will have hundreds of millions of dollars flow through his hands. And I see a man, blah, 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 blah." And I described the man and his features and so forth. And I said, "There's a tattoo on his arm." And I described the tattoo on his arm. And I said, "This man and some others will be in a position where they will literally extract resources from this young man." And it went on and on and on and on. And the enemy will make an attempt to steal his very life. But God says, "Mom, stay in your position, in your calling, in your mantle." And I said, "There'll come a time when he'll say to you, 'I am sick of my own sound.' And the sound of heaven will be birthed in him because he's called to release the sound of light in the earth to a generation." And so I could hear her crying and sobbing. I said, "Jeff," I said, "man, I don't know." I said, that one's really one that you might have to retract, because I said, "That's wild." He said, "Greg, do you know who you were prophesying to?" I said, "I have no clue. You didn't, I don't have any clue." He said, "You were prophesying to Patty Bieber." And I said, "I don't know who Patty Bieber is." He said, it's Justin Bieber's mom. And I said, I don't know who Justin Bieber is. I didn't. And Jeff said, oh, man. He said, Patty's over. Good thing Patty's over here on the floor. She's out. The power of God's all over her. He said, because you'd have just embarrassed yourself. I said, bro, just apologize for me. He said, no, no, no. He said, take your phone and go in there. Do you have a computer? I said, yeah. He said, go in there to your computer and pull up Justin Bieber. And I said, okay, how do you spell it? So I go in there to my desktop and I pulled up and typed in Justin Bieber. And I said, oh my God, Jeff, Lord. I said, man, you'd let me make a fool of myself. He said, yeah, dude, you just don't know. Well, long story short, over the years, it's been awesome. She would call literally. In fact, if you remember, Danny, when we did the meetings out here in Northeast, what we call them?
In Northeast?
Yeah.
You talking about the worship nights?
Yeah.
Yes. Now, in Irmo.
No, out in out Northeast off of 77. And remember once a month we'd do something. Anyway, I several times in the middle of those things, I'd get a call and I'd have to go out and go outside where I could talk. And different times when Patty would call and say, Greg, I need you to pray, blah, 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 blah. Would you prophesy because right now things are really looking bad. And I just talked to her about a week ago again. And the phenomenal things God's done to fulfill every single thing that God spoke almost 9 years ago. But one of the things God declared, in addition to the fact that he called her one day and said, Mom, I am sick of my own sound. but the recording guys pulled him off the road. He was in the middle of a world tour, pulled him off the road and brought him into an event. And I'm going to be real careful on how I describe it, but I'm going to just say, because you can listen to Justin's testimony. But it was a satanic ritual that they had set up and they literally ended up taking his girlfriend, fiance's baby's life in that. And it made him so sick that he was throwing up. He left with his security people. And again, listen to his version of it so that, again, it was the root of it was satanic ritual abuse. And they basically said, if you, they did that to create fear and to intimidate and to harass, and basically said, if you do these things, and they wanted him to participate in some things, if you participate in these, you will literally ride the heights of the industry, as if he didn't already, you know, he would never lack for, you know, he would literally go, let me say it differently. We'll say it backwards. There are entertainers, Hollywooders, musical industry people that because they did what they did, they're at the height of their careers. They'll never, they'll be insured for the rest of their life.
Right.
Others who pulled away, they lose all their backing. But the awesome thing again is God says righteousness and justice are the foundation of my throne. Right now, if you pay attention to the news and to the real news, not the fake news, and understand what's going on, they literally, I saw one headline in the real news, that said Hollywood is literally clearing out and they're running for their lives.
Yeah.
Because of subpoenas and indictments that are already taking place. And I'll just stop at that because there's a lot of stuff, but and government officials all the way at the top, there's a person all the way at the top who is, her name is, she's known as Jezebel, Queen of the World of Satan. She is.
Wow.
She's at the top. Everybody could guess it, no, but basically, yeah, that's what she's known for.
Wow.
And the vileness of depravity, yeah, of them taking kids and not only molesting them and raping them and so forth, but they take them to the next step and use them till they are physically just meat. And then they torment them to the point where they're at the edge of death and they see others dying and your adrenal glands produce a chemical called adrenochrome. And that's what they literally, the elites, take and drink. And there are restaurants in Hollywood that have human flesh that they serve. I mean, this is all documented. This is nothing. I mean, and then the last thing they do is they take their life and then they cannibalize them. Now, this is all documented stuff,
yeah,
that happens every single day. The point I'm making is that the church has just, they've understood that there's, you know, abortions and so forth, but they have no clue that this is the very foundation of the satanic ritual abuse that has been ongoing for decades, generations.
Yes.
You know, and the thing that I want to say about us as prophets, because I could talk about that a long time, but I don't like to talk about it. The church has had their head in the sand.
Yeah.
And it's time to get your head out of the sand and stand. Get out of the walls, get out of the building. That's one of the reasons God messed everything up. Like you were just saying, you know, get out of there.
Yeah.
You know, I love that Rodney Howard Brown is, you know, having meetings in tents, you know, even though he's got a phenomenal building. He spent $100,000 to cleanse it and all that. He's chosen to go into tents because the heathen are coming into those tents in Tampa, Florida, and getting born again and getting delivered, getting set free, you know. But the church has had their head in the sand, and I call it spiritual navel gazing. They've looked at each other's belly button and prophesied each other's belly button and pat each other on the head and forgotten those who are almost dead from the darkness. And so the thing that I keep wanting to charge everyone again with is we are called for this time to literally see a transformation of people that are, their lives are so screwed up, far more than we ever could have a clue. Man, I've had an education in the last 10 years that's really, man, it's messed me up because I had no clue. I was sheltered, you know, and we just didn't know, but it is coming out. It is being revealed. But the most important thing is where there has been generational curses on families and I'm finding it more and more and more. In a recent prophetic boot camp, prophesying to people, just going down the line and prophesying to people, you know, over and over and over and over, God's given me, for me, a key sometimes. He'll say, when I look at someone, specifically, most of the time, it's more women or young ladies than men, but I'll hear the phrase, it's not your fault. It'll come out of my mouth before I can stop it. And I know that's a key. That they have been sexually abused, molested, destroyed, and they're trying to pull out of the tentacles of that and the umbilical cord that hell locked into them to destroy their marriage, their mind, their lives, their everything. And just recently, and I just, again, going down, it's not your fault. And they just, all you say that, the first words out of your mouth from the heart of God, and they immediately hit the floor. I mean, just sometimes just screaming because God's bringing deliverance and wholeness to them. They've never had someone just declare that, you know? But what I wanted to say is we've been given an opportunity to, instead of generational curses and just delivering people from generational curses, we've been called as prophets to release and declare generational blessings.
Yeah.
Generational blessings.
That's so good.
And from 1,000, Jesus, God said his word to 1,000 generations.
Yeah.
Blessings, blessings, blessings. And so we have that life-giving word that can transform them and set a, literally cut the horse and the rider and see it thrown into the sea symbolically. That's another key the Lord speaks. A lot of times I'll be talking to or prophesying to someone. In the middle of it, God will say, I'm going to release the horse and the rider, and he's thrown into the sea. And I'll know then God's wanting to break generational curses over them, physical curses, you know, he had sickness, disease that's stalked and it's gone from one generation to the next. Sometimes it may skip a generation, but it's showing right back up. And God says to them, you're the one that's going to break and end the generational curse, and you're going to start generational blessings over your family. Yeah. And that's such a joy to know that. And they just brighten up, you know, light comes, revelation comes, and they're released from the darkness, the bondage, the umbilical cords, and the tentacles of hell, and they're set free. And that's, again, an opportunity we as prophets can do to see. And that you can do that. You can do that in a restaurant. It don't have to be in church.
Yeah.
You know, in the side of a building.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, that's so Bieber has stepped into a place, and phenomenal things that are in front of him. God's declared that. He always speaks ahead of time. We know that. Yeah. I'll do nothing, but I'll first reveal it to my servants, the prophet. And he spoke that all the way back there 9 years ago when he was 16 years old. And God has let that thing unfold one thing after the other. And the joy of it is Patty, she's a powerful prophetic intercessor. And she called us to just say, hey, I just want, the Lord told me, he put you guys on my heart. She did not know what we were going through, the things that you're aware of with the house and all that. She just called and said, God said that you need to know that he knows where you're at, knows what's going on, and he's going to put and release to you blessing upon blessing. What the enemy's stolen from you, get ready, because it's coming. I'm just, woo, you know. Thank you, Lord,
that's so
for that.
Good. That's awesome, so, Greg. You know, one of the things I just want to say to those who are watching, you know, Greg has shared some things, and some of you, I know, some of you are going, oh, that's kind of extreme. It's like, no, actually, this is actually historical. This goes back all the way through time. It goes all the way back into the Old Testament. These activities are normal. We have learned how to cut off certain parts of what is actually happening in the world so that we feel not responsible for what's happening. So we feel clean from that. But it is so important for everyone to understand that these are issues that we as believers need to carry to the Lord, and we need to be voices to speak to these things. This is Josiah tearing down the altars. This is this is Hezekiah coming and saying, no, we are not going to worship the Baals and the Ashtaroth. This is Elijah on Mount Carmel who basically is saying, no, you cannot. The Lord, he is God, not Baal, not Ashtaroth. And the reality is that those who do those things do not get to continue doing those things. And there is a reality that God is, he's absolutely exposing this in this hour. And I knew that there was a facet of that you're carrying, but we do walk in the light. We don't become overcome by it. We do not become depressed by it. We pray, we seek the Lord, we weep, but we understand we are the light of the world. And as the light, we bring the light, we release the joy, we release the presence. We actually call people who are walking in darkness to come into the light. That there are those that we're going to see, and the Lord has shown me this. There are those who will be like the Apostle Paul, murderers who will come out. That there will be those who have been in heinous sin, wickedness, that God is going to pull out. But right now there's an exposure, and exposure is a good thing because exposure releases the place where the blood of Christ can cleanse us from all sin.
Yes.
That's what it is. It's not bad that exposure is happening. It's good. It's good. And so deep darkness covers the earth. It surrounds the earth, but his glory, his light will shine on you. It's so good. So good. Greg, I want you to pray for us. I actually would really love for you to pray for, because you mentioned something, and man, it really, I felt the Holy Spirit really all over it when you were speaking, particularly the young women. And I know there are young men who have been molested. I know, and they're fighting. They're literally fighting. How do I overcome this? How do I, I don't want to enter into this cesspool or this journey into stuff that now has been exposed to me. And now what do I do with this? And I'd really like you to pray for us. And I don't know. And if the Lord gives you anything, this is going to be a delayed broadcast, but I've learned that we don't fight God on architecture, that in this architecture that God can speak to somebody 3 or 4 hours from now, that he's going to speak to you about right now, if the Lord gives you something. And I want to encourage you just to release that, but I really want you to pray for those who are watching right now, who are walking through those things.
I want to read because carrying his presence is the key.
Yeah.
I'm a worker.
Let me interrupt for because I want to hear that again. But one of the things that the Lord has had us on, he put us on a mission when all this, he shifted things for us big time. And he said, I want you to equip the church to function like the underground church. He said, it is the most effective church model in the earth, and nobody wants to do it. But he said it is the fastest growing, quickest, and we know that from both China and from Iran. Mm-hmm. And I said to the Lord, I said, Lord, are we going underground? That was the first. And he said, whether you are or not, this is still the best method. And so, of course, you realize that's in homes. But the Lord said, it's not about the houses.
Yes.
He said, the thing about the underground church is their utter, complete dependence on hearing Holy Spirit. That we have to hear the Holy Spirit about where we meet, when we meet, how we meet, with whom we meet. That literally it's learning how to hear what the Holy Spirit is telling us to do right now. And you were speaking about that earlier, and that's what you've been doing. I mean, all the stories that you shared was, you listen to the Holy Spirit, you just obey him, you do what he says. But now I want you to share what you were going to share, because I think that I could hear where you were going. Go.
Well, again, as prophets, we've got to be the most radical of worshipers. We've got to, number one, love the word. And then as we take the word in, that's what's going to come out. It's either going to be in paraphrase. Sometimes the word, literally the word, will be in the content of what we minister, but it'll be the word. It'll be the same God breathing out. And so that's number one, vital. The second is absolutely loving and abandoning ourselves to his presence, to where we carry the ark. We are a prophetic Davidic company. And, on the seed of David, the root of David, the house of David, everything has to do with David. And this is one of my favorite passages of scripture as a symbolic picture of what you have the opportunity to do everywhere you go. And it's in 1 Samuel 5, and it says, beginning with verse 1, the Philistines brought the ark of God from Ebenezer to Ashdod. And they took the ark of God into the house of Dagon and set it beside Dagon, their idol. And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon had fallen upon his face on the ground before the ark of the Lord. So they took Dagon and set him back up in his place again. But when they arose early the next morning, behold, Dagon had again fallen on his face on the ground before the ark of the Lord, and his head and both of the palms of his hands were lying cut off on the threshold. Only the trunk of Dagon was left of him. And this is the reason neither the priest of Dagon nor any who come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod to this very day.
Wow.
That's such a powerful prophetic picture of what you and I have the opportunity to do as carriers of the ark of his presence everywhere we go.
Come on.
When we go, everywhere you go, don't you know that when you get in there, that the Dagon, the idols, the spirits of darkness are going to topple. It's just because of who you are as a carrier of his manifest presence and power and his word and his glory.
Amen.
And the kabod of God gets rid of the kabod everywhere you go. And so I just can't challenge you enough that's not even formal prophetic training. That's not even formal prophetic ministry. That's just being who you are. And with power, literally seeing the Dagons and the idols and the darkness fall and all the things come dismantled, and the kingdom of God is being, where everything is being dismantled, the kingdom of God is being constructed in the earth. And that's what you and I are called to do. And I'm just praying right now, Father, for those who have had the darkness of hell, that princes and powers and wicked spirituals and rulers of darkness, perverted spirits that have over years and over generations and over family lines and generational DNA. And so many people there's been two generations that have been hidden in darkness. Their deeds have been hidden in darkness. But Father, this is a season where you are with your light of revelation, releasing people from the tentacles and umbilicals of hell that have had them bound and oppressed and depressed to the point many of, there's several that I hear right now that you don't know what else to do, and you've gotten into such a place, these demons haunt you, stalk you. In the night season, you dream night. You have nightmares, not dreams. You have visions. You are put in places and circumstances, and you feel the darkness of hell and the breath of Satan breathing on your neck because you had that happen in the natural. But God is saying to you today that even though you have some even have contemplated ending your life because you don't see a place of deliverance, a place of help and hope. But I declare to you today, by the word of the Lord, I release an impartation of to people that they will be delivered and set free by the glory of the Lord, by the manifest presence of the Lord, by the word of the Lord. For the word of the Lord is sharp, like a two-edged sword. It is the two-edged, two-mouthed breath of God, the two-mouthed sword, and it cuts both ways, and it severs, and then it heals, and it restores, and it delivers and sets free. And I declare you are being set free. There are those that even prophetic, and you're linked into this prophet's chamber, and you have been used of the Lord, and yet you go from those places of being used of the Lord, and you are you go back into that place, and hell begins its accusations, and the prophelying of hell that says you don't deserve it, you're not good enough for it, and you're not worthy. God says, I made you worthy. I sealed my covenant with you by my blood. And so the darkness of hell, there's some who have had abortions.
Yeah.
And the accusations of hell have said, you are not worthy. God says, I paid the price with the blood of the Lamb of God, my son. You were created in his image and our likeness. Therefore, you've been set free.
Yes, Lord.
And brought into a place of liberty. From this day forward, you'll not be harassed, and you'll not be accused. The accuser is not going to be able to have a voice anymore. His prophelying will end.
Amen.
By the word of the Lord, I seal it today.
Amen.
And I want to remind you, Psalm 8:2 says that when you praise, praise silences the enemy. That means it plugs up your ears from hearing his prophelying, and so that you, and it says it silences the enemy, and it stops in his tracks the avenger from coming any further to you.
Amen.
And so those nightmares, those night visitations are going to end. But you must take the word of the Lord, the sword of the Spirit, and with the high praises of God in your mouth.
Amen.
And a two-edged, two-mouthed sword. First mouth is what God says, and the second mouth, you must declare it. And faith comes by hearing the word of the Lord. Your own ears, hearing your own mouth, declare his greatness.
Amen.
And you'll see the enemy stop. And that silent, that prophelying will stop. Those voices will end today. Amen.
So good. So good.
Amen.
I'm grateful for you, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you, bro. It's a joy.
Thanks for being with us. And I look forward to seeing you again shortly.
Yes, sir.
We are actually part of our journey involved a word we were waiting for. We're still
Can
very
I just tell you what it is?
What's that?
The word is, when are you gonna return?
Oh, well, it actually holds a piece of that, but it was something where we're not done here. We're still going to maintain a base here, but we're also going to be, resurrecting, or whatever we want to call another base down south as well. We're not sure exactly where that's going to be, but we know that there's more to be done, and we have an army in the South, not just South Carolina, but there's a bunch that we need to pull back, and there's some other stuff happening actually out west as well. So we're kind of
awesome.
excited, and I look forward to seeing you again.
Absolutely, bro.
You bet. Love you much, man.
Love you too, man.
Bless you. Bye bye.
Give care and love.
I will. Okay. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Children, may his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family. your children and their children and their children. May his faith.